Welcome to the Faith Lutheran Church Bible Study, The Triumph of the Lamb, a study in Revelation. Tonight in our Wednesday class, we discuss the fall of Babylon from Revelation chapter 18. Let's listen in.
Let's pray. Father, thanks for this day. Thank you for the opportunity to study your word and for the beautiful weather you have given us today, Lord. And we pray that as we study this word, you would guide us with your spirit tonight. You would guide our conversation and you would bless us in the things that we hear and receive from this word. We thank you, Lord, that you hear and receive our prayers. And we ask you, Lord, to answer them according to your will. We pray for Tom as he prepares for surgery this Monday. We pray, Lord, that the procedure would go smoothly. And we pray, Lord, that they would remove everything that needs to be removed and that he would be healed. Lord, have mercy on him. We pray for Ron and Esther. We thank you, God, for 60 years of marriage for the two of them and for the example they are to the rest of us. We pray, God, you would continue to bless them and strengthen them in their marriage. And we thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness to them all this time. We give you thanks that Ace had a successful surgery and is doing well, and we pray for his continued healing. We pray for those who are battling the fires up north. We ask you, God, to bring to send rain and bring restoration. We pray, Lord, that the people there would not face any more destruction because of these fires, and be especially with those who are fighting the fires. Be with Jack and his troop as they fight the fires, or keep him safe and watch over him. Also watch over Rachel and Mike and Hope and Hannah and Mary. Please bless them through this time and help them to figure out the good course to take ahead, and please continue to grant Rachel strength and healing in her body. Have mercy on us now, Lord, as we study your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. We are in chapter 18. And remember we said we're kind of dealing now with the end of all things. So this is the final judgment that we're going to be looking at here today. This is the judgment that is going to come upon Babylon. Babylon has been depicted for us thus far as a whore riding a beast, the whore of Babylon riding the political beast. That whore was also a false prophet before, and then a religious beast earlier. Continues to kind of morph throughout the text, but now the judgment will fall on both the political and the spiritual beast in the fall of Babylon. Babylon symbolizing Rome for John, but also symbolizing, frankly, any power that exists before the second coming that stands opposed to the church. So it's talking specifically about Rome, yes, but also beyond that, it's talking about anything that might stand opposed to Christ's mission here in this world. This is the final judgment that will take place upon the powers that be, you might say. Okay? And this one gets pretty bleak, but it is important for us to go through. So, any questions or thoughts before we go forward?
One thing I find interesting is that God used Babylon when Israel misbehaved, when Israel would not be true to God. He used them. And now, it's like now he's punishing them, or now he's putting them in their place, showing the world what they really are.
Yes, that's what he did with Babylon before. Mm. Right, yeah, before this.
Yeah,
Babylon, because of that judgment, is a picture of everything else that is to come. But yes, that's right.
It's interesting. He uses any and all things for his purpose.
That's right. And we can also say for the good of those who love him somehow. So and that was the promise God made. If you break these commandments, the foreign nations will come in and take over. And Babylon was the one God used to judge Israel, but even there he was sovereign, which is very interesting. Yeah, yeah. Okay. All right, so let's dive in. Someone want to read for us chapter 18, verses 1 through 8, please. Thanks, Marjorie.
After this, I saw another angel coming down from heaven. He had great authority, and the earth was illuminated by his splendor. With a mighty voice, he shouted, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become a home for demons and a haunt for every evil spirit, a haunt for every unclean and detestable bird. For all the nations have drunk the maddening wine of her adulteries. The kings of the earth committed adultery with her, and the merchants of the earth grew rich from her excessive luxuries." Then I heard another voice from heaven say, come out of her, my people, so that you will not share in her sins, so that you will not receive any of her plagues. For her sins are piled up to heaven, and God has remembered her crimes. Give back to her as she has given. Pay her back double for what she has done. Mix her a double portion of her own cup. Give her as much torture and grief as the glory and luxury she gave herself. In her heart she boasts, I sit as a queen, I am not a widow, and I will never mourn. Therefore, in one day, her plagues will overtake her. Death, mourning, and famine, she will be consumed by fire, for mighty is the Lord God who judges her.
Okay, so, this is bad news for Babylon. This is Babylon's dark side of the moon, something like this. I'm going to get a reference in there some point. So now we have another angel coming down out of heaven. This one has great authority. Now, how do we know it has great authority? Describe this angel to me, and what is the nature of its authority? What is it coming to do? Describe the angel to me.
He's lit up.
He's lit up. Like at a Pink Floyd concert. That's right. Yes, that's very good. He's lit up. What does this mean?
He comes from God.
That's...
We need to back up.
Whatever you want to call that guy, I suppose. He comes from God. Yes, very good. Now, notice this. He comes from God with great authority. To me here, he's somewhat reminiscent of Moses. Because this is not his own glory he brings. I mean, some people will argue this is Christ. I don't think that's a good argument to make. But he's when Moses leaves the presence of God, having done his work of authority and oversight and judgment, in the tabernacle there, he comes out and he would have to wear a mask because the glory would shine forth from him and be kind of blinding to everyone else. Well, here, there is no more mask. And this one is reflecting the pure glory of God, and it is hard to see for the sinners, you might say, because he comes in judgment. And if we're going to associate, which John does in his, well, Jesus does, in John's Gospels, if we're going to associate Moses with the law, this is the judgment that is now coming on all of creation. Well, at least all that is in creation that has opposed Christ. So, yeah, we kind of have a Moses-type angel here. Go ahead.
There's another way to read that.
Uh-huh.
This angel has great authority, but it says he had great authority, and the earth was illuminated by his splendor.
Mm-hmm.
You could read that also to say that the dark things of the earth, all the things that were hidden,
uh-huh.
were shown.
Exposed,
by the presence of this,
sure.
this angel. With great authority.
I think that's great. I think that's the right. That's a better reading there. And what we're seeing there then too is the judgment exposing everything.
Yeah.
So the whole earth. Yeah,
that,
very
that
good.
Kind of illumination as
and
opposed to.
I'm not sure that's the one you want to get the star for, but there's the illumination on you. That's right. And so, very good. Yeah, I like that. That's great. So here comes this angel, and it's scary news, especially if you're Babylon. So what does he say about Babylon? She is what? Fallen, done for. Now, the description here, when you think of Babylon, you want to think of a thriving, wealthy metropolis. It's the center of commerce. It's the center of all cultural influence. It's like the center of life. It's New York. It's Los Angeles. And like when you picture those cities, you picture lots of people, lots of movement, lots of action, a lot of influence taking place from this centralized location. So that when you hear of those places, at least here in America, we think of life or things taking place in the city that are producing for the rest of the world, something along those lines. Here, that is falling. It is no more. It is being destroyed. And this thriving metropolis of a nation, this Babylon, this Rome, this whatever it is, has now become a dwelling place for demons, a haunt for jackals, a haunt for every unclean bird and detestable thing, unclean spirits. And what you see here, I think, is perhaps the former center of the town is now a haunted house. The picture here of all these evil spirits kind of hovering over this place, and this the commentary says, all that is left of the once proud city are demons hovering over a corpse. See, it's a very, I mean, for lack of a better word, haunting picture of what we see taking place there now in Babylon. Now, what is interesting is in the Old Testament, at the fall of any kind of nation, this kind of language is going to be used, that you will be become the haunt of jackals or wild beasts or something like this. And there's a twofold purpose there. One, it's to demonstrate that the life that used to exist here, the influence and the power, are gone, and it's a place to be feared. Wild animals are there. You don't want to go there. There's no human life, no good for human life, something like this. But the other side of it is, in the Old Testament, wild animals depict foreign nations. So if wild animals are going to come in and take over a city, that's another way of saying these foreign nations are going to come in and conquer you. So to be run over by jackals is another way of saying, you know, I don't know, Assyria. We'll just pick Assyria. Assyria is coming in and wiping you out. So in other words, what you're seeing here is both the decimation of Rome specifically, and not just the fall of the city, but the fact that others will come in and destroy it. And I figure it was the Goths, the Visigoths, or someone like this who came in and destroyed Rome. Ultimately, I don't remember the right name. I think they were the...
That was the Huns.
The Huns? Attila the Hun?
I thought it was the Huns.
Perhaps so. I don't know. I'm guessing. So, yes. So there you go. And so there's the destruction of the city. Go ahead.
No.
Oh, I thought that was a vocal hand raising. Okay. Now, this becomes kind of a terrifying thing for all the nations, because they have drunk the wine of her passion and her sexual immorality, and the kings of the earth have committed immorality with her, and the merchants of the earth have grown rich from the power of her luxurious living. So the idea here is basically that all of the center of all commerce and all commercial wealth and all power in the world was centered in Rome. And now Rome is destroyed. And the nations are too going to be in trouble. And notice that they're being punished for what they've done. Because they've given these people all these wonderful, great, powerful, mighty things and taken them away from Christ. Pointed them to something else for power in their faith. The nations of the world trusted her, that is Babylon. They drank the wine of her passion, you might say. Their faith was in her eternality or something like this. And now it's gone.
All that commerce and all that lifestyle, an antichrist?
It could be an antichrist. Now we'll talk about the antichrist later. I don't know if I want to say it is the Antichrist or an Antichrist per se, though we could say it this way. Antichrists will preach a gospel of put your faith in wealth and not put your faith in Christ, though maybe in the name of the church especially.
And debauchery and
sure,
you know, everything
right.
That goes with
or anything that is not Jesus, yeah. Even if it's something good and not Jesus. Right, right.
I was just going to say that you just mentioned it. The way that we've talked about that Rome in the past has also been referred to as the city of seven hills. It also, I think, is called the Eternal City.
Oh, is that right? Is that a fact? Yeah, well, that doesn't last very long.
No.
That kind of eternity comes to an end. And we'll see that here very, very soon. Okay, anything else here? Nope, okay. Anything else you guys have here? Okay, keep plugging along. Then I heard a voice say, come out of her, my people, lest you take part in her sins, lest you share in her plagues. There was conversation earlier about whether or not the church is still kind of around while all the bad stuff is happening. And it seems to me that this is kind of proof that the church has been around during the other plagues and other things we've seen. Because now if we're at the final judgment, and at the final judgment God is saying, okay, people, come out. It seems to imply that they have been around for quite some time. They've been on the earth while the other plagues were going on. But now, as this is the final judgment, the church certainly does not go through the final judgment the way that the rest of the world does. And so the people are coming out of her, of Babylon, who is receiving the final judgment. There is some debate over who is saying this, come out of her, my people. It makes it sound like it's God. But then later on, it's going to say something like, mighty is the Lord God who has judged her. So who is speaking here? If it's not God, it's someone on behalf of God. If it's Christ pointing to the Father, you know, it's kind of inconsequential. Go ahead, Tom.
Well, it says that it's another voice, so it's not the same angel.
Correct. Yeah, this is not the... We can say that much. It's not the same angel. Yeah, absolutely right. Yeah.
But it could be another angel.
Could be, though it says my people, and the angels do not possess the people. Mm. See? So... I mean,
it's interesting that he would make a big deal out of the angel and say, and if it's God, he says, and then another voice says,
yeah.
You know, like,
yeah, I mean, it is kind of curious.
Why didn't he stick with the angel?
Yeah.
And say, oh, there's this guy that came out and he was had great power and illuminated things, and then God says,
yeah, that's an interesting point, yeah. Yeah, it's hard to think of God being referred to as, oh, another voice.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So maybe the angel is identifying itself with the people or something like that. Who knows? But even if it's not God, the angel is speaking on behalf of God. So it's, you know, a good guy speaking right now. Okay. And notice this coming out. This is a pattern we've seen throughout the scriptures. When God is going to pour out an ultimate judgment on something or someone, he calls for a coming out of. So think of Sodom and Gomorrah in the story of Lot. Right? Lot is there in Sodom and Gomorrah, and the two angels go down to visit, and they're invited out for drinks by the locals, you might say, to put it lightly. And
very lightly.
Yeah. And the angels say to Lot, yeah, we're pretty certain this place is getting destroyed. This place is way out of hand. You need to leave. And Lot says, well, where should I go? And they say, to the mountains. And he says, no. No, I vacationed there last year. Where else would you have me go? But I mean, it's funny. He like talks back. These angels come like, we're wiping this place out. God is pouring out sulfur and fire. And he's like, no, I'm not going where you're telling me, because if I go there, I'm going to die. And they're like, yes, and if you stay here, you're going to die. So finally, he sends them off into the mountains, and Lot flees, and Lot's wife turns around and turns into a pillar of salt. And the part they leave out of the children's Bible is... then Lot's daughters recognize that they have no men to sleep with and have babies, so they get their dad to sleep and they have sex with him while he's asleep. I mean, just the stuff of Genesis you don't always hear in the Sunday pericopes, but that's the story. And what's interesting there about the salvation of Lot is, remember, there's three angels who come to visit Abraham and Sarah. And two of them go down to Sodom and Gomorrah, and Abraham detains one of them and starts speaking to him as though he's God, which we would then think that that angel was not actually an angel, that it was God. And he starts to barter with God. If there's 50 people there, you're going to destroy a whole city if there's 50 people who still are faithful to you. No, I won't destroy it if there's 50. Okay, well, now that I've got your attention, how about 40? And he keeps going down. And I think the subcontext there is, I don't want you to destroy Lot. Please save the place for Lot's sake. And notice what happens. At the end, God saves Lot. And I think we can say, out of faithfulness to Abraham, out of his love for Abraham, he saves Lot. It's kind of an interesting story. But notice that Lot is to come out of the city. Same thing with that story in Exodus, or Numbers, I should say, with Dathan and Abiram, who I'm pretty sure this is the story. I just don't feel like looking it up in any of the classes. But it's the one where I think they've talked back to Moses and says, Moses is leading us astray. And so Moses says, fine, you stand by your tents and everybody else come out from their tents. And if God's on your side, you'll survive. And if God's on our side, you're getting crushed. Everybody come out. So everyone comes out except for Dathan and Abiram, and turns out their houses get destroyed. I think they're swallowed up by the earth or something like this. Seems like there's enough, maybe it's fire from heaven, yeah. But yeah, come out from them so you're not destroyed by them. Jesus says at the fall of Jerusalem in Mark 13 that you should flee for the country when this thing starts happening, because there will be a persecution like nothing the world will ever see. So get out of the city. Run for your lives. Woe to you women who are nursing in those days. Because it's not easy to travel with children. I mean, that's kind of what's going on there. And then lastly, St. Paul uses this language and he says, don't be yoked with unbelievers. Don't let their practices and their way of life creep into the church so that it begins to lead the church into destruction. Separate yourselves from them. So kind of an interesting theme throughout Scripture. Now here God is coming for the last time and saying, come out, because the wrath is about to come. Notice it does not take place in a rapture 7 years before the end of all things. It's taking place here at the end of all things, the final judgment. Okay? All right. And then this language, for her sins are heaped as high as heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. This calls to mind, at least for me, and I didn't read this in the commentary, so maybe it's off base, but I think there's something to this. It reminds us of the Tower of Babel. And what was the work of the Tower of Babel? Build a tower to the heavens. And not just to build a tower to the heavens, but to centralize the government and to make sure that they had all the power located in one place. And they could have influence and strength, and they would make a name for themselves and all of this kind of stuff, and they would do so by building this tower to heaven, not as a way of finding out the hidden things of God or something like this, but as a ziggurat, which was an ancient form of worship, a temple, and it was a means to claiming heaven for your own or something like this. And so that's what they were doing in Babylon, or Babel, and God says, no! We're going down. We've heard that this is not going well. Let's check it out. Yep, we're getting rid of this thing and we're spreading the people out across the earth because God had commanded them to be fruitful and multiply and
fill the earth.
And they decided, no, we're going to stay put. This is good land. And so that's what happens. And so their building, their greatest work, their ziggurat, the thing that they sort of gathered around and were proud of, was their greatest sin. And so God destroyed it. And now here, Babylon, which was near Babel, I think, or now for our purposes, Rome, this massive city, and we all know the story, right? Rome wasn't built in a day. It took a long time, and it was a lot of glory, and there was a lot of power, and a lot of strength, and it was the greatest of all human feats was Rome. You know, I mean, and we even still talk this way. You know, I was working through John Adams' biography, and the way that, like, Jefferson and those guys speak of the Greeks and the Romans and their style of government and all of these sorts of things, we still idealize that empire on some level because it is the greatest of human accomplishments. And God says, your sins are piled up to heaven, and I'm going to wipe them out. The greatest of man's accomplishments are the greatest of man's sins. And so here comes that kind of judgment, the same kind of thing we see on Babel. Yep.
Going back to the Tower of Babel.
Yep.
I always thought that it wasn't the fact that they were building the tower,
uh-huh.
which they could never reach heaven. Mm-hmm.
Anyway. Right, right.
But their self-centeredness.
Yes.
The fact that they held their own ingenuities, et cetera, higher than they worship their God.
Yes, correct.
They cause them to be broken.
Yes, that's correct.
Which has a real analogy to us today.
Yeah, the building of... Yes, it absolutely does. That's absolutely right. I mean, this is something Americans need not sneeze at. This is a very important thing. But when we talk about the tower, yeah, it wasn't that they were trying to climb up into heaven like you hear in the Sunday school stories, but rather that ziggurat was sort of a monument to them and their gods and what they were worshiping. So so when we say build a tower up to heaven, the ziggurats were seen, we did this in Crossways, I think this is right, the ziggurats were seen as places where God met humanity. Not unlike the Hebrew temple. Right? That's where you met God. That's where he located himself. But the difference being God saying, I'm not bound here. You know, you can't control me with this thing. The ziggurats were a way of manipulating gods and all that kind of stuff. And so it was a form of worship to build that ziggurat. Yeah.
There's kind of a statement in there, though, that they were building a tower to reach into heaven. But if you read it real close, then I think almost the next sentence says, and God came down.
Yeah. Oh, that's a pretty good thing there. Yeah. That's pretty funny. Yeah.
You have to keep an open mind sometimes reading Scripture, but some things are just downright funny.
Yeah.
And that's one of them. God came down. Oh, what are you guys doing?
Yeah. Oh, how impressive. I heard something was taking place down here. Yeah.
So, but...
Yeah, that's a great way Because that text is the same thing with the Sodom and Gomorrah text. There's almost a strange, like to us who we were very big on the omnipresence of God, the all-knowingness and the ever-present, all-knowing God. And in those readings of both Sodom and Gomorrah and Babylon, or Babel, in both instances, he's like, well, we've heard something's going on around here. We're going to come check it out. There's almost an ambivalence that you read there of God towards those things. Is it because they rejected him or whatever? But, you know, that's an interesting... Oh, that's pretty good. Sorry, Tom, you're out right now. That's very good. That's a good connection.
God has a sense of humor.
Yeah, yeah, that's very good. Okay. And sometimes he's also not very funny, like here. Pay her back. And here's again God's memory showing up in a bad way. When it comes to our sins, we would prefer a forgetful God, you might say. Cast me not away from your presence, O Lord. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. What's the line? Forget. Oh.
We got to go back to those.
I read it this morning, yeah. But something, there's a verse along lines of, remember not my sins, or something along those lines. And it's a prayer we actually pray, and God says, you know, because of Christ, yes, yes. I cannot think of the line.
Created me a pure heart, O God, and so, renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain you. That's in the liturgy.
Yeah, that's Psalm 51. Oh, goodness. I will think of it in the middle of the night and send you all a text message or something. But there is a prayer in which we pray for God to... forget my sins or remember not my sins or something like this. And here we see what happens if he recalls them. We like the part of the liturgy he recalls his promises. You know, that's the good stuff. It's the memory of the sin. That's the scary stuff. What does he say? As far as the east is from the west, so far as are your sins removed from you? They're sitting in the bottom of the sea. Forget it. Oh.
But as far as our sins, once we come to faith in Christ, our sins are gone.
Yes.
Okay? This is the direct opposite, because these people are, in fact, the direct opposite of the believers in Christ.
Right. Yeah, and so I think we said it this way this morning. I think this is helpful. They are now dealing with God apart from Christ. Mm-hmm. They're dealing with the God of the law, you might say, which doesn't make God a bad guy. It makes God bad news for sinners. His law is just. And that's the hard part for us in all of this, that God is right in his judgments here. He's righteous in his judgments here and just in what he's doing. And we kind of talked about this morning. That's the hard part for us to wrap our minds around. This seems awfully harsh, and yet he's doing this the right way.
And it's not just that he remembers her sins, but he pays her back double.
Yeah, yeah. She gets what she deserves. Yeah, something like that. Yeah, yeah. Go ahead. All right. So, she glorified herself and lived in luxury. So give her a measure of torment, a like measure of torment and mourning. Now, I want us to, and I didn't do this in the other classes, but I think it is helpful to remember the reverse of this as well, that the church at the hands of Babylon has received what? Torment and mourning. And now, as we'll see at the end of this chapter, they receive rejoicing and a cause to give thanks because they've been rescued from the Babylon, the clutches of Babylon. But Babylon, who rejoiced over the suffering of the saints, is now receiving what she deserves, the suffering that the saints had themselves. What she is receiving, she gained luxury at the lives of other people. Now, because of that, she loved herself more than others, she's going to suffer. Okay? She says in her heart, I sit as queen, I am no widow, and mourning I shall never see, and for this reason her plagues will come in a single day, and death and mourning and famine, and she will be burned up with fire, for mighty is the Lord who has judged her. I mean, just terrifying stuff. The hubris or the pride that comes before the fall here is really quite something to see. Did you, I think you said it tonight, maybe you said it earlier, that Rome was the eternal city. Was that tonight or this morning? It's a very long day. That Rome is the eternal city. And so the Caesars would stand up and say, see, nothing's taking us away, taking this away from us. You think of Nebuchadnezzar in the book of Daniel, who looks over his kingdom of Babylon and says, my, I've made a very nice home for myself. I truly am a remarkable king. And then God makes him crazy for 7 years or 7 months or something like that. Yeah. And so, he goes crazy. And then at the end, the last we hear of Nebuchadnezzar, this evil, wicked, terrible king, he's repenting and singing praises to God. It's very interesting. God kills him before he makes him alive, before he dies. The one I like to recall the most, though, is Herod. And you remember the story of Herod in the book of Acts, where there's two groups of people who are at odds with each other, and there's a great frustration between the two of them, and Herod is able to discover a peaceful treaty between both parties. And at the end of it, they're very thrilled with Herod, and Herod goes out, and they're all standing kind of below his window like Romeo and Juliet or something like this, and they all start praising and saying, oh, Herod is, he speaks with the voice of the gods, you know, and all this. And Herod says, you're right. I mean, you're right. It's true. I mean, I don't want to brag, but yes, I do speak with the voice of the gods. And so then the god actually strikes him down dead, and he's eaten by worms from the inside or something like this. And now we hear that story, and it's one of those stories you hear that and you go, well, there's one of those weird Bible stories that makes me wonder if I can really trust this book. That's just a weird thing. The nice thing about that story is that it's corroborated by Josephus, who was a Jewish, a decidedly not non-Christian scholar, a Jewish historian who lives at the time of the fall of Rome and Jesus and all of this. And he records that account from Herod, and it sounds almost exactly like it does in the book of Acts. Kind of interesting stuff. So it's corroborated outside of Scripture, which is always a nice reaffirmation. And so you see this always with these nations who think we just cannot fall. We're too powerful. We're too strong. Pride comes before the fall. And I've told you this about America, just so we don't get too comfortable tonight. I was once listening to a radio show where it said, America is the most powerful nation in the history of the world. And then I was going to the Getty down in Malibu that day, and they had an entire display on Rome and like how it existed for 1,400 years as the most powerful nation in the world. And I thought, we're like the idiot little brother who thinks he's smarter than everyone and is in a lot of trouble when he picks a fight with the wrong. I mean, we could be in trouble for that kind of pride, you know. So nations come and go in that way. Germany, incidentally, when Germany rose under Hitler, it was the pride of Germany that allowed for that kind of rise. You know, Hitler's cry was, we're going to restore Germany's dominance. We're going to restore the pride of Germany. I mean, look at our great culture and our history. We have Bach and Luther. I mean, he would name all these great history Germans of the past and say, see, we are the great nation that needs to rise again. And that's what people got behind. That kind of stuff. So, interesting. Okay.
And Hitler lasted what, maybe?
Not a real long time.
10 years, maybe?
Yeah, not a real long time. Yeah. All right, so then.
We're past due.
Okay. Anything else on that? The fire destroying the Jeremiah, when he talks about the fall of Babylon, speaks the same way about fire destroying Babylon in his vision. And so the connection you want to be making between Rome and Babylon is Rome will fall just as Babylon fell. The reason we're using Babylon as sort of a descriptor is that Babylon had a number of similarities. It opposed the people of God, one. It was the most powerful nation in the world, too, and it fell with a great fall, three. And Rome's going to do the same thing. Now, John is witnessing these things 400 years in advance for Rome, and he's also probably witnessing the downfall of all that stands opposed to Christ, including Rome, but everything, every power, nation, and all of this that comes up against Christ's mission before his return. Okay? Okay. Yes?
I happen to wonder if he clearly is referring to Rome when he says Babylon. Is it possible that part of the reason that he says Babylon rather than Rome is because of the fact that it does mean more than just that one city, and that at that time, if he would have said Rome, perhaps these scriptures wouldn't even have existed, but they would have been sought out and persecuted even more.
I don't know if you can say that, because that last part I don't think is quite fair to say, simply because the rest of the Christian New Testament would have been read as being in opposition to Rome. Calling Jesus Lord and all that stuff would have been cause for them to wipe those things out, but they didn't. So I don't think we can make that argument. What was the first question you asked?
About.
Oh, is this, yeah, is it referring to, yeah, maybe that's why they used Babylon.
Because again, getting back to what I said this morning, that otherwise this just makes it a historical text.
Correct.
As opposed to something that is yet to unfold throughout the ages.
Right. And we talked about that, yeah. So there's a view of Revelation, and I think we talked about this at the beginning, maybe not, that suggests this is strictly an apocalyptic book speaking of the historical fall of Rome. Like, that's the only thing it refers to. So all of this is not a pattern for life until Jesus returns, but rather just a big biblical apocalyptic picture of the fall of Rome. This is called the preterist view, and Marjorie looked up what that meant, and I still don't remember, and I even read the email. It's Latin for past or something like this, things that happened in the past. And so some will say you should not read Revelation apart from the part where Jesus returns. You should only read it as God saying, here comes the fall of Rome, just like you would read Ezekiel in that apocalyptic literature about the fall of Babylon. Like, that's what it's talking about. And that's one way to read it, though I think it's probably more fair to say what we in the Lutheran Church take a partial preterist view. And what a partial preterist view says is, yes, it is referring to Rome, and was fulfilled in the fall of Rome, and will be fulfilled with every other power that stands up against the mission of the church. So yes, we will include Rome in that, but not limit it to Rome. That this is the pattern of life until Jesus returns. So they're going to look at things like, just off the top of my head, the Unholy Trinity gathering at the Euphrates, right? And they'll probably try and find some historical event where a nation gathered against Rome around that area and say that's what it's referring to and only that. It seems like the same problem of dispensationalists only in reverse, where we read the newspapers to interpret this text, where they read the newspapers to try and figure out Revelation. Those people only read history books to figure out Revelation and don't look at the theology and the scriptures themselves as the guiding principle. Does that make sense? Joyce, then Tom.
John is looking at visions, mm-hmm. and he's interpreting them. He's making sense to himself based on the Old Testament. All through Revelation, he keeps referring to things. Mm-hmm. So why would he stop now?
Yeah, and right. I mean, what they'll say is that those Old Testament allusions are referring to historically identifiable events. That's their argument would be that. I don't agree with it, but I think that's what they're going to say. Go ahead.
If he's describing a historical event, it's not accurate. I mean, even if it's a prediction of a historical event, it's not accurate.
How so?
Rome didn't fall in one day.
Yeah, right. It didn't happen immediately.
It wasn't even close.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, it was 100 years or so before they were really completely taken out. So it's not like one day everybody fled the city and the Huns came in or whoever.
Yeah, God wiped it out.
The Gothers or whoever came in and wiped out the city. They didn't have anything like that.
Right. And so, because what we're witnessing here is an immediate destruction of everything that mankind has kind of built up against God. Yeah, that's right.
He's obviously talking in a much larger context than just Babylon.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, and
now again,
the preterists would say yes, in that larger context is the Roman Empire.
Okay.
And I'm going to say I don't like that interpretation. I think it's actually because it's, I would say, partially true. It's in bounds. I think it's an easier argument to make that than it is to make the dispensationalist argument that says this is, you know, the church is raptured out and this is all going to happen in a certain way. In a sense, we might say we're a mix of both of those, because we're saying this is describing the past, the present, and the future. It's doing that, all of that. on a certain level. So it's setting up patterns for us. Though here, I would suggest it's not talking about the fall of Rome, but specifically, but in fact, the fall of that Babylonian spirit, you might say, or that power that is at work by the power of the devil, the great dragon. It's describing the great dragon's works as being destroyed completely once and for all. I think that's the best way to read this. And instead of trying to pinpoint it as only Rome or only the future one world empire or whatever, just say all that has been worked by the devil is being judged here.
That makes sense.
Yeah, go ahead. I think so too, and I think I wish I would have said it a lot more times. Go ahead,
Dave. If you look back at ancient history, Babylon was probably the greatest of all of these civilizations. And so when you come to a book like this where it is symbolizing something, it's symbolizing all of these powers that come along. And you can go back to Egypt, and you've got the same problem with Egypt. Egypt falls under that description of Babylon. The Assyrian Empire falls under that.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you come along to the Medo-Persian, and the one that we don't talk about much in here was the Greeks.
Yeah,
and the
yeah.
destruction that they imposed on Jerusalem.
Right, right.
And now you come to Rome, and you know the Turks after that, and you know, we come up to our more modern history of Hitler some of the ISIS-type stuff. Now, who knows what comes next?
Right.
But
right.
it's all based on the symbology that was created by the power of Babylon and its attitude that I am the greatest
right.
type thing.
Yeah, very good. Yeah, it's the pride of the nations.
It's the pride.
Why did Constantinople get the works? It's nobody's business but the Turks. Do you know that song? Good song. They might be giants. It's a great song. Okay, anyways. Istanbul is Constantinople. Now it's Istanbul, not Constantinople. And if you've got a date in Constantinople, she'll be waiting in Istanbul. You guys don't know that song? It's too bad. Okay. All right. Pink Floyd, you something else. All right.
I want to know. It's not Pink Floyd song.
No, it's not that. All right.
Depeche Mode?
Well, no. They might be giants. Good heavens, not Depeche Mode. Oh, Marjorie. No.
Babylonian powers.
Yeah.
Had Caesars.
Or kings or lords. Yeah.
And they all seem to either do good or they do bad.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I mean, some of this you might want to say in the secular realm. They weren't all bad. I mean, that's what's some of the attraction. I mean, some of the reason why Rome is so attractive is they were doing good for the world. It's just that it ultimately came to the point where that good was done in the name of worshiping Caesar or something like this, you know. We got a scholar, well, I think you can make this argument that even under tyrannical governments, God is still accomplishing good things. People are still being fed, you know. Life continues on. Even under this tyranny, and the tyranny will be judged, but God continues to remain faithful and cause the rain to fall on the righteous and the unrighteous. You know, it's kind of an interesting thing. So
given that statement, where do we in California stand?
Yeah.
Not on a lot. Yeah. Okay. Look, let's just say this. If we're suffering under any sort of tyranny, this is one way to suffer, I'll tell you that much. All right.
Empires rise and fall.
All right. Now watch what happens. I think this next part is just absolutely fascinating. This is when Babylon fell, Ezekiel has a vision of the fall of Babylon, okay? And he sees this fall of Babylon, and there's like a funeral procession, a funeral song sung by the kings and the merchants and the seafarers of the world at the fall of Babylon. So again, here, we're going to see the same thing here in the fall of John's Babylon and the fall of Rome and then all these other powers at the Last Judgment. You see those who had put their faith in these things mourning. Singing funeral dirges, dirges, whatever you want to say, singing those things in sorrow and in fear. If someone could read for us then, chapter 18, verses 9 through 10. We'll just do two verses at a time here.
Okay.
Thanks, Tim.
When the kings of the earth have committed adultery with her and shared her luxury, see the smoke of her burning, they will weep and mourn over her. Terrified at her torment, they will stand far off and cry, "Woe, woe, O great city, O Babylon, city of power. In 1 hour, your doom has come."
Yeah. Now, Rome, despite what Tom said, Rome wasn't built in the day. But at the last judgment, it will fall in a day. And I think the image you want to have in your mind here, though it's not a one-to-one correlation, obviously, is what they're experiencing is much like what we experienced with the falling of the two towers. Because here's this thing that was massive, that took a lot of energy, and I mean, people, we had pride in the two towers. There's a symbol of New York, right? These two towers. I mean, this is, and New York is central to the life of America and all this, and there's a great amount of pride and sort of confidence. When you see those things, you're like, ah, yes, America, right? That's industry and money and so much taking place there with world commerce. And they just fell like that. In a morning, they were gone. And here's the kings of the earth who had trusted Rome and not God for their daily bread. And Rome had been built up for so long and done so much. And they're watching the fall of this thing, and they're saying all of man's work being destroyed. And we trusted that. Oh, nuts. Now we're in for it ourselves. You know?
Yeah. Like their this. Personal loss.
Yeah.
How they're going to feel.
Yeah, and what they're going to lose because their faith was in Rome and not in God. I think also they sing this dirge, this woe, woe. If your interpretation hopefully says woe and not, mine says alas.
That doesn't.
Woe is the funeral song. It's funeral music. So when Jesus says things to the Pharisees who are standing in front of him, "Woe to you," he's saying you are as good as dead because of these sins. You know, yo. So woe, woe to them. And there's a hint of and woe to us. I said this is. I think this is a good example. One of the fearful things on that day. That light you used earlier is the exposing of all of the sins of the people. Remember, is it James or not a word that's spoken, or Jesus or someone says not a word that's spoken in private will not be hidden or something like this on the day of judgment. All those things we wanted to keep secret and didn't want people to know about here exposed. And if you're not in Christ, if you're not hidden in Christ, it's a terrifying place to be. The feeling of these kings is much like the feeling of those 36 million or whatever folks who had visited AshleyMadison.com a few weeks ago. Do you remember this story? Ashley Madison was the adultery website that if you wanted to have an affair, you would just visit this website and you could find someone else who wanted to have an affair with you, which is great. But it got hacked into, and they got a list of everyone who used the service. And so there was, and they got like, and I'm not kidding, it was like 36 million names. I mean, just disgusting of people who had used this website, and they threatened to expose them if Ashley Madison didn't shut down. And I'm just thinking that the people who saw this on the news, about 36 million of them were kind of feeling like the kings in this thing, like, oh, we thought we were safe. Oh, we thought it was okay. And we are now exposed. And it's a great amount of fear. There. Go ahead.
Another example that comes to mind, I can imagine, would have been when the stock market crashed in 29, whenever the great stock
market crashed, the Great Depression,
where people were wiped out in the matter of a day.
Yeah, that's right.
You know,
that's good. That's a good example.
Who would have thought that would ever happen?
Yeah.
And people jumping out of buildings because they just saw.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, the utter despair.
Yeah. Well, they lost everything. Exactly.
Yeah. Everything was taken away, just like that.
Right.
And the same thing here. And there's nothing you can do about it. There's no control. It's completely gone. Yeah. All right. So that's what you have going on there. And I think that's the attitude of the kings, but not just the kings who recognize that the fall of Rome means the fall of their kingdoms, but also the merchants. Can someone read for us 11 through 17?
I got it.
Thanks, Ron.
and the merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her, for no man buyeth their merchandise anymore. The merchandise of gold and silver and precious stones, and of pearls and fine linen and purple and silk and scarlet and all fine wood and all manner vessels of ivory and all manner vessels of most precious wood and of brass and iron and marble and cinnamon and odors and ointments and frankincense and wine and oil and fine flour and wheat and beasts and sheep and horses and chariots and slaves and souls of men.
Keep going through 17, please.
Okay. And the fruits that thy soul lusted after are departed from thee, and all things which were dainty and goodly are departed from thee, and thou shalt find them no more at all. The merchants of these things which were made rich by her shall stand afar off for the fear of her torment, weeping and wailing, and saying, alas, alas, that great city that was clothed in fine linen and purple and scarlet and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls. For in 1 hour so great riches has come to naught, and every shipmaster and all the company and ships and sailors and as many as trade by sea and stood afar off.
All right. There you see kind of the destruction from the perspective of the merchants, those whose commercial interests and livelihood depended upon commerce with and in Rome. A couple things I want to notice here. I don't know if this is on purpose, but in that long list of items that were used for commerce, it's basically just a list of what was sold in the markets there. There's not too much to read into it. I think it's a similar list to what you see in Ezekiel, though. I want to notice a couple things. This may not be on purpose, but there is a psalm that says, some may trust in horses, some may trust in chariots, but we will trust in the name of the Lord our God. Horses and chariots are listed last here, perhaps to call that to mind, maybe not. But then after that, you have slaves. That is, mine says human souls or human lives. And there is something to be said for the dehumanizing work of slavery that is taking place there in Rome. Slavery is not always dehumanizing throughout the history of the world, though certainly at this point, if you're buying and selling people as property, it's kind of dehumanizing. Again, we have this blood on our hands in the history of our country as well. I mentioned already, I was reading John Adams' biography, and Thomas Jefferson, boy howdy. If you ever read David McCullough's John Adams biography, fantastic book. I mean, it's really a good read. But I was interested to see more. I'm really interested in Thomas Jefferson for some reason. This guy just fascinates me. Until I read this book, and he's just kind of like a scummy kind of guy. He's not a great guy. He overspends. He loves luxury. He loves, you know, tons of stuff. He has big homes and a lot of slaves. And he'll write against, you know, the evils of slavery, but keep them. Because in a sense, when you're addicted to stuff and when you're addicted to wealth, it doesn't matter as long as this person that is around you can be used to help you gain more of that. And that is ultimately what happens here in Rome, and the dehumanizing work that's taking place is, hey, look, we can use those people to gain more wealth for ourselves. And so slavery and the love for luxury, the idolatry of luxury go hand in hand. When my life and my stuff matters to me more than humans, other people. So. Okay. I wanted to make a connection with abortion, but I think I'll just keep moving on. Because that's the same thing. If my idol is my choice and my freedom, then this thing is just getting in the way. To my happiness. Dave, but also here what you see is there's a great amount of idolatry and worship of money, people who love their wealth. And listen to what James says to those in the church who love their wealth. James 5:1-4. Dave, if you could read that.
Okay.
Now listen, you rich people, weep and wail because of the misery that is coming upon you. Your wealth has rotted, and moths have eaten your clothes. Your gold and silver are corroded. Their corrosion will testify against you and eat your flesh like fire. You have hoarded wealth in the last days. Look, the wages you failed to pay the workmen who mowed your fields are crying out against you. The cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord Almighty.
Okay. And so you see there that in James, the church that he's writing to, even some of the people there are bad slave masters. And they're using the people for more money. And the Sabbath laws in the Old Testament when it comes to slavery, I think it's Deuteronomy. Sabbath laws come up twice. And in Deuteronomy, the reason why you take a Sabbath day is so that you're not abusing your workers, so that they have a day to rest, and they too rest and worship God because they too are created in the image of God. So the way slavery was working in those days was not race-based or class-based. It was the way of the economy. You have someone who has a lot of property and he hires people to work on his property. It makes more sense. It becomes a dehumanizing thing when those people cease to be employees, so to speak, and become property. And that's when the problems arise. In James's church, he says you love your luxury, and so you're not paying your workers. And now you're going to suffer for it, and God will judge you for that. He's talking to people in the church at that point, which is very interesting. And in Rome, 60 million, they had 60 million slaves at one point in Rome. But that is an institution that is going away on the last day, because in the kingdom of God, there's Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female. And this is the radical, one of the radical issues in the church, in the early church, is they were saying things like, when you read Corinthians, the slaves get to have the communion meal alongside the wealthy. They don't have a separate room. You're one in Christ Jesus. Jesus is dining with all the wrong people, see. And so in the church, the last are first and the first are last. And it's those who love their firstness that oppose and oppress the last and do so for the sake of money and wealth. And these are the merchants who are weeping because now all their hope and all their trust and all their comfort is destroyed. Go ahead.
The whole, in everything that's mentioned, the common thread is their worship of other than God, whether it's money or power or whatever. Mm-hmm. If you're not worshiping God, you're doomed.
It ultimately always comes back to the first commandment. Mm-hmm. It always comes back to the first commandment.
That's what God is judging.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Yes.
Well, this passage from James is particularly condemning because this was verse 4. The wages you failed to pay the workmen who mowed your fields are crying out against you. There was a law in the Old Testament that said you were supposed to pay them at the end of the day.
Oh, right. Yes. Yeah.
And so they're not bothering with that. So this guy that has worked all day for you and hasn't got his wages, he can't eat. He doesn't have anything.
Mm-hmm. There. But you're gaining from his.
You're gaining from it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's particularly in the church itself, which is what James was
right
condemning here. That's particularly harsh.
Yep. So it's, Paul says to Timothy, tell those who are wealthy to be rich in good works. You know, that's very good. Okay.
I don't see what you see about if they're not worshiping God.
Worshiping money or worshiping power or worshiping whatever, they're not worshiping God.
Right, but I see they're not helping other people.
Sure. Yeah, and that stems from, so the worship of God is going to produce the fruits of love for your neighbor. The worship of other things besides God mean you have to rely, how would I say this? If you're worshiping money, then people to you become a means to getting more money because they're going to work in service to your God. Whereas if you worship the God of the universe, the people around you are children of God who deserve your love because God has loved them and given his son to die for them. And so the way your God is viewed is going to shape the way your treatment of other people is viewed. Or the way you view God is going to shape the way you treat other people.
So they go hand in hand.
Right. So you can have Allah, who can justify violent uprisings, because, hey, he's the one true God and people are working against him. You can have Jesus, who loves his enemies and prays for those who persecute him and cries out from the cross, "Father, forgive them," and that's going to shape the way you treat people who oppose you. You know, you see what I'm saying there?
Yeah, yeah.
And so if your God is money, people become a means to an end to gaining more money and gaining more wealth, and not someone to serve and to love. Yeah, yeah, good.
And God is not criticizing money. It's all right to have money.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
what you do with them.
Yeah, 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 of course.
And the scripture says that you're a rich man hoarding your money at the end. That's the sin.
Yeah, it's the rich, the other is the rich man with the barns who goes to bed at night saying, "Well, look, I got a nice retirement package for me." and so now I don't have to do any more work. And I'm going to keep this all for myself and hoard it. And then God comes in the night and says, "You foolish man, I'm killing you now." Yeah. I don't think he says, "I'm killing you," but it's, you know, he dies. And God's in charge of that. So, I mean, that's kind of what happens there. This is to be given and shared and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, yeah, okay. All right.
My footnotes are just full of people. You know, use your resources to help people and advance God's kingdom. And then this is a neat one here. Is how can a person keep away the evil system? And the five things, it says people must always be more important than products. Number two, keep away from pride in your own programs, plans, and successes. Number three, remember that God's will and word must never be compromised. Number four, people must always be considered above the making of money. Number five, do what is right no matter what the cost.
Yeah, that's right. That's very good.
And then there was a time that I actually had canned beans and canned corn, and feared
not having something to eat.
Right, if things went bad, riots happened or whatever, I could sustain my family. I realize now, just by reading Revelation, I was a fool. Because when people came to my house, I wasn't going to protect my food. I would be,
that's right.
I would be feeding those people now.
Right.
Things
so there's
changed. You know, when you start with Bible study stuff, you start changing the way you live.
That's right. Yeah. Good.
You're saying you make a lousy survivalist.
Yeah. That's right, yeah, yeah. Don't hide in Sheldon's house. That's it.
Gun safe full of gun.
Or the way to do it is run into Sheldon's house with a gun and you get a meal. I mean, that's the way. All right. And again, here they are, woe, woe for the great city. They're also singing this. And again, for in a single hour, all this wealth has been laid waste. Just gone. Lastly, the shipmasters and the seafaring men and sailors and all whose trade is on the sea stood far off and cried out as they saw the smoke of her burning. What city was like the great city? In the Old Testament, you see this, that when cities are destroyed, they become a byword, something that people shake their heads when they think upon this, something like that. That's what you see happening there. They threw dust on their heads as they wept and mourned and cried aloud. Alas, alas, for the great city where all who had ships at sea grew rich by her wealth, for in a single hour, once again, she was laid waste. So they depended on her for their daily bread, and now she is gone, and they are done for. But then there's this, and in my text, I think it's the same in all your texts, it looks as if this is still the shipmasters, and now they are telling the saints to do something. Suddenly they're giving a command, which is very interesting. Rejoice over her, O heaven, and you saints and apostles and prophets, for God has given judgment for you against her. Now, is this an angel speaking or is this the defeated speaking? I don't know, but it seems on some level to make sense to me that it could be those who are defeated saying we've lost, conceding. Those saying before we were the ones rejoicing over the luxuries of Rome, and because our faith was in her, we are done. But God has justified you. He has declared your faith right and said, you are receiving the kingdom while we are losing it. Go ahead, Tom.
Well, I'm trying to figure out who it is this time. The last people they identified was a sea captain.
Yeah.
But then they don't really define, will throw dust on their heads and cry out.
Yeah, I think... That is the sheet. It's going to be the sea captain because the referent is going to be to the previous.
It was plural. There's no modifier there, then.
It's plural, though. If you read the first part of it, every sea captain and all who travel. No, but ship,
all sailors, yeah. And
yeah.
All,
yeah, yeah.
And they're living from a seal standpoint.
Yeah.
So it's everybody that earned an income.
By probably commerce, bringing all these spices and everything else back to Rome.
Yeah.
So is this a stock market crash? I mean, what is it? Really? In an hour? What can happen in an hour?
This is the end of, this is the judgment day, the end of all things.
I know, but how does everything come to a screeching halt in an hour if it's not like the stock market or something like that?
Because God just destroyed it.
Oh, destroyed it physically?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I think that's how you want to read that.
Yeah, if you're looking at the end of time, it would happen.
What?
Nero playing while Rome burned?
Yeah, so yeah. But he's not playing anymore here. No, he's in trouble too. Yeah, yeah.
He killed himself.
Is that how he died?
Yeah.
Well, Nero?
His former wife helped him kill him.
Love and marriage, you know, that's keeping quiet, Ron. That's very good.
Yeah. Think about all the accumulated,
that's right.
Just,
it's over.
Don't go there.
Was that a story Esther was reading you this afternoon or something? I just want to be very clear on. All right. So then a mighty angel takes up a stone like a great millstone and throws it into the sea, saying, "So will Babylon, the great city, be thrown down with violence and will be found no more." And now we're going to get this chorus of "no more," which really does get very scary as you start to read this and you pick up on the cadence of this thing. Babylon will be found no more, and the sound of harpists and musicians and flute players and trumpets will be heard in you no more, and the craftsmen of any craft will be found in you no more, and the sound of the mill will be heard in you no more, and the light of a lamp will shine in you no more, and the voice of the bridegroom and the bride will be heard in you no more. For your merchants were the great ones of the earth, and all the nations were deceived by your sorcery. They trusted in you, their faith was in you, and you let them do it. And in her was found the blood of the prophets and of saints and all who had been slain on the earth. All this at the cost of the lives of the saints. But notice this pattern of no more. And all these things that come with joy and celebration and wealth and comfort just completely gone. No more crafts, nothing more to be built. No more music to be heard. I mean, that is... For us, I mean, it's ominous for them, but I mean, I don't even know if we can imagine a world where you don't hear music every time you walk in a store or turn on your car. I mean, just utter silence, but not a relaxing silence, a fearful silence, because God is now against you. It's not like going up to the cabin and actually enjoying silence, you know, like the kids aren't here right now. This is amazing, but it's a bad silence. No more mill on... No more light of a lamp will shine in them anymore. And then I think this one is interesting. The voice of the bridegroom and the bride will be heard in you no more. And there's a twofold purpose to that, I think. One, weddings represent the furthering of life, the continuing of families. Despite what our modern sexual ethics teach us, sex actually is aimed at having children. And that is located in the marriage relationship. It's not the only reason for sex, obviously, but it is located within the marriage relationship, and its goal is procreation and the joy of family and the furthering on of life and all that kind of stuff. And that's gone. There's no more wedding celebration. This morning I was reading, I'm in a one-year Bible plan. You ever done a one-year Bible plan? Do a one-year Bible plan. It's 15 minutes of reading a day. It's not terrible. But... Right now, one of the texts we're working through is Genesis. And the best thing is they're doing Genesis, then Chronicles, and Luke and Acts first. And those are always the hardest ones for me to read, so we're just knocking those things out. Genesis is always fun. But when you get to Genesis, to the chapter where Jacob brings the family down to Egypt, and Joseph You know, there's all the forgiveness and the reunion, and it's almost a resurrection scene. It's really quite remarkable. And they receive this great land from the hand of Pharaoh. When all this takes place, there's the genealogy there being read, saying, and this was Issachar's family, and this was Dan's family, and these were their descendants, and 70 in all, and all of this. And what you're seeing there with those families entering in is God's faithfulness to his promise to Abraham. As many as the stars in the sky will be your descendants. And right here in Genesis chapter, I think, 46, 47, the stars are coming out. Yeah? You're starting to see some of them. And God fulfilling his promise. The sand and the seashores are beginning to gather. And life is continuing on through Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the people of promise. Here we have the opposite. No more life. No more. Is the phrase that's used. Now, there's a second level to this, because in the next chapter, we're going to read about good news, the celebration of the church being united with Christ at the resurrection, and the marriage feast of the Lamb, the bride and the bridegroom, being united. So when it says, the voice of the bride and the bridegroom will be heard in you no more, that means the hope of salvation is gone. The church is no longer preaching Christ to you for forgiveness and life and salvation. Those voices are gone from you, and the hope of salvation is done. Does that make sense? That's the language that is at play here, and I think that works on both levels there. But this is what they have coming because they have killed the saints. The blood of the saints is on their hands. All right? That did not sound good. And I wish, yeah. All right. Any comments or questions at that point? Okay. Go ahead, Tom.
I think there's a corollary. I'm not really sure I want to make this point. I think there's a corollary between this type of destruction and what we currently see going on around us in terms of world trade and that sort of thing.
Okay.
In this particular instance, it's just one city that's been destroyed. You know, there's nothing's going on. But nowadays, everything is so dependent on computers, you know, and trade mm-hmm. that takes place within those computers. And a computer, it's a very fragile thing, right?
Yes.
It's a very, very fragile thing.
Ask the Ashley Madison people, right? Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, it could be an hour. And
sure.
An electromagnetic bomb goes off in a few places in the world, and all of a sudden all the computers don't work
That's right.
anymore. And you've got a real problem. Famine would happen very, very quickly. Stores in Simi and those places, they don't carry more than day or two of their food.
Right.
They got to get food from other places. It's in constant flow. They don't want to stock it. They just want to have it come in and sell it and get more. So this sort of thing could happen in and out.
Mm-hmm.
Or in a very short period.
Sure, sure.
All of this.
Yeah.
Kind of ugly stuff. We've set ourselves up for that.
Yeah.
You know. And it's my prayer every night when I go to bed that the Lord won't judge us like that. At least until my grandchildren.
Yeah.
And maybe my great-grandchildren are going to beat those. And something good so far. But, anyway, you know, that it happens after that.
Yeah, and I think, now, we don't want to say that this is directly pointing to computer bombs,
but
it is, at the same time, not an unwise thing to say, look, are we putting our trust in, this is the new system where we're trusting, it's the internet. And that is how we are finding our security, that all my stuff is safe in the cloud. This has got to be like the dumbest thing I've ever heard in my life. Like, your stuff is not safe in a cloud that you don't even know what that means, right? But hey,
yeah.
I'll put it all there and just trust that the people at Apple or whoever runs the cloud are trustworthy.
What I'm saying is that we've placed our trust, in that technology.
Yep.
Only we've set ourselves up for the very thing that that John's talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And that will happen. It's happened in the past in other ways. It's happening now in this way, and it will probably happen in the future if there is a future.
There's a great book, Amusing Ourselves to Death. Have you ever heard of that book? I can't think of his name, but Amusing Ourselves to Death. Neil Postman, phenomenal book. But he says everyone is scared of 1984, right? Was it Orwell? We're all scared of this, and you know, the government coming down and Big Brother and all this. And he says that's not the right book to read. We need to be scared of a brave new world where we've done it to ourselves. And technology is exactly where we're doing it to ourselves, that we're setting for ourselves all these comforts and all this stuff, and we're trusting that, and we're going to be getting to the point where we're so dependent on it that we don't mind dehumanizing people and taking things away from others so long as we can sort of sustain our comfort with a pill and a computer screen. I mean, it's a very interesting argument. Sheldon and then Dave, yeah.
I think this is the greatest thing ever, and I think it's exactly what God's been waiting for us to set ourselves up like this, because there's going to be no better way for God to get everybody's attention than to cut the power off on everything and say, here I am. And everybody's going to be angry at God. They're going to drop their phones. They're not going to have...
They're going to drop their phones.
But I guarantee you one thing, God will have everybody's full attention, and that's awesome.
Yeah, that's right. And I think that's the promise and the fear of the whole thing, is that when he returns, this is all done. And every knee will bow and every tongue will
confess. There's no better way to get everybody's attention.
Yeah. Well, yeah, yeah. Yeah, go ahead. Dave.
Well, Tom's business about the electromagnetic pulse, you know, you don't even have to be on the internet for that. If it goes off, and that's essentially generated by a nuclear weapon of some kind, but if that pulse goes off, it can fry electronics for everything, you know, miles around. But, you know, we've done some other things to ourselves. Think about where particularly Southern California is right now with water. We had this California aqueduct, and if you've ever driven by that, it's just huge. And when I was still in college, watched them build that thing. You can't imagine the monstrosity that thing is and how much water it will flow. An endless supply of water, right? Well, go up through Castaic there where it used to be flowing over the hills. It's dry.
Yeah.
And you know, it's happening.
Yeah. Because we have such a love for luxury. Yes, Joyce. Yeah.
We're trying to dream up ways for God to end the world. It doesn't matter. He can end it any way he wants, and we would rejoice because he's come.
Yeah,
he's now. We don't care if the internet doesn't work. We don't care if the phones don't work. We've got God.
Correct. Yeah. I don't think anyone's saying that the internet downfall is going to be the end of the world, but just saying, like, this is another example of how we've put our faith in the wrong thing as a world, and it's going to be something that can come back to bite us. And it may be the end of the whole world, or it may be another 2,000 years. The point being, it's just another entity that will not sustain your faith. That's the whole point, I think, we're being made here.
Can we not believe and have faith in God and use the internet?
No one's saying otherwise.
Right. Well, I don't understand why this would be our downfall. We've got many, many ways of doing that.
You're thinking in the mind of a Christian. You're a Christian. I'm talking about the non-believers. It's a great way to get their attention.
Non-believers have a...
You already have full focus on God. I'm saying the other people that don't.
Right. The point there is... The internet is another place where people are finding security and comfort apart from Christ, perhaps. Perhaps. And it might be something else.
Perhaps.
I mean, it's fine.
But can you not also say that God gave us the means and the intellect to invent?
Yeah, I don't think, again... no one's saying otherwise, but always remember that idols always come from good things.
Okay.
Idols are always good things that God has given us that we misuse.
Okay. It's the misuse.
Yeah, because even your daily bread, no one's going to say stop eating bread... But if you, I mean, this is the reading we've been seeing in John 6, right? Mm-hmm. Jesus, we want more bread. I'm the bread of life. Yeah, we want breakfast, right? See, I mean, like, there's a dependence on something besides Christ for daily bread. And so idolatry, and I think the fear should be for us, not that we're idolizing the internet or something like this, but it's a recognition that our idolatry runs so very deep that we are always constantly needing to repent and look for how we're looking for things besides Christ to put our hope and our trust in.
And that's my point about, like, the California Aqueduct. We've essentially created an idol there.
Right, and I would say, and here again, like, the problem is not the aqueduct, but it's the idea that we're somehow now in control. We've got this managed. Yeah. And at any moment, God can say, control's gone. What are you going to do now? And it's at those moments where we're forced to do nothing but turn to Christ. Yeah, yeah. Go ahead, Tom.
Well, my original point, we should remember, I said I didn't even know what that should make. You
know? Yeah, way
only,
to go.
It was only to say that before you write off this sort of, it happened in 1 hour, it could happen in 1 hour.
Yeah, right.
Okay?
Yeah.
That these words are as pertinent today to us as they were to
yes,
people that,
exactly.
that John
yeah.
was writing to way back in
right.
the AD,
yeah.
the Ravens he wrote.
Right, exactly.
Okay? Because we just continuously set up these things that allow us to be knocked down.
Right, right.
Think about your prayer for Jack and what happens in 1 hour in a fire.
Sure, yeah.
We drove through Monitor Pass on the way to the cabin, on the way up there. And this was a fire that started, what, kind of the end of June or early
yeah,
July?
First of July.
And it was going to go through, they have that so-called California Death Ride, which is a 140-some-odd-mile bike ride up there. And they went down, like, to the week before, not knowing whether or not they could carry it out because of this fire. And it's just amazing the destruction that took place. About 20,000 acres, roughly, were burned. And that's a small fire. That's a small one.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
a lot of that probably happened within... literally
out. Yeah, it's amazing.
So, a lot of ways.
All right. Well.
Well, we got you to 8:30.
And we didn't get to the Antichrist, which is just fine with me.
I think we've been talking about
it. We will do the Antichrist next week. Maybe. Steph and I have been talking about going camping at some point this summer, because we do need some kind of break. Last week was not a vacation, so I think it's either next week or the following week we're going to do it. So just watch the announcements and watch all that. And what did I tell them this morning? Expect nothing and plan for nothing or something like that. Expect everything and plan for nothing. Yeah, that's right.
Bible studies so, next week or no?
That's what I'm saying. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Watch your emails.
Yeah, watch your emails. I did have the Jews for Jesus lined up to come next week and talk to us, but I think I'm going to push that back a little bit. Unless I'm not here, maybe that was the bad thing to do. Maybe I should have kept them. But I'll push them off a few more weeks.
Okay. My computer crashed this week completely. I mean, like, to the point where I unplug it and it says starting Windows and it freezes. So I already have a guy coming out Friday, and I'm thinking to myself, why waste my money? Because I don't have computers in hand anyway.
Well, yeah, but I mean, that's where you're going way too far.
Okay.
Don't worry. These are, yeah, that's where Joyce is absolutely right. Like, these are good things. They can be useful tools. They make bad lords. And so the way the world works right now is by means of computer. I mean, that's how we communicate. It's how we work. It's where a lot of commerce takes place. It's fine. It's not a bad thing. It can become an idol. My favorite illustration of this is Dostoevsky got a book called The Idiot. It was a great book. But in there, there's like this crazy old drunk. Dostoevsky's an old Russian writer, and he's always got just delightful drunks in his book. But he's got this crazy uncle drunk guy in that book who's been reading Revelation and has figured out that what the beast really is the train system. Because what's happening is it's going to unite all of Russia together, and they'll create this one world Europe, and it's going to ruin all things. And I remember reading that and getting done and going, crazy old Russian drunk has a point. this makes a lot of sense, actually. It's the trains that ruin everything. That's why Dostoevsky's a really good writer, or I'm just a really dull reader. But the whole thing is, you can plug anything in. Are trains sinful? No. No, it's the way the world works right now. And I mean, it's fine. The problem is when all of our ducks are in that basket, or we use those things which are good gifts and make them into lords, you know? And that's where the problems arise. But we should have no problem using the tools of this world with great joy and comfort and faithfulness to our Lord, knowing that we're serving our neighbor through it. No problem with it at all.
There are those who have abused the cell phone, the smartphones.
Uh-huh.
You go to a restaurant, a family of four, and they're all on their phones. They don't talk anymore.
Nobody's going to talk.
You know what?
Nobody's going to talk.
If they didn't have those phones, you'd be complaining that all they did was fight at the table. So I think it's like a real blessing. That
That's interesting.
Have you seen my kids at a restaurant? Phones aren't always that bad. All this stuff has issues and problems and all of this, but that doesn't mean phones are inherently a problem. It means that we have to work harder on the family structure. I mean, that's really what's going on with that.
You know, the internet, the church uses it. That's how you get announcements.
Sure, I understand, but my wife pays the bills on her computer, and all I've been playing a video game on my computer. For like 5 years. And now that my computer's crashed this week, I realize I made it a point to hit that
computer screen.
You have to feed your people, you have to trade, and is that becoming an idol?
No, Sheldon, for you, the chargers are an idol. Everything else is fine. I just said that because it's going to drive him nuts now. I'm joking. You can watch football. It's okay. That's not. He could easily just as well point the Broncos
out to
me. No, look, someone agreed with me on that one. The Chargers, that's not a good thing. But the idea is, look, again, if it gets to the point where like you're ignoring your family to play the computer game, then it's a problem. But if it's your means of kind of coming home, blowing off some steam by feeding the farmers or whatever, fine. There's nothing inherently sinful about entertainment unless you're a Puritan, and we're not Puritans, and so we enjoy these things.
It drives her nuts when I tell her, like last night, God doesn't want me to have technology anymore. My phone's broken. My computer just died.
Sheldon, that's not a sign from God. That's just laziness with keeping up with your updates. That's all that is. That's like me saying God doesn't want me to have a garbage disposal because it's not easy to keep up. It's not that means. You're trying to see, what does Bonhoeffer say? Don't be more spiritual than God. Right? Don't try and find the spirit in everything. Because it's usually not that.
But don't you ever believe that everything happens for a reason?
Not really.
No.
Honestly, no. I don't believe that. I think things just happen sometimes. I think some things happen for a reason. But I think sometimes the world just kind of runs according to God's system, the way he's created it. Not that he's a deist and he's not. I think he's involved with everything. I don't think he's removed from anything.
Right.
But I think there's a lot of things going on that he just says,
okay,
yeah, this is what's happening. And I'm not going to, you don't need to think about my will in this apart from the fact that my will is for your good. So you don't need to think about, are the clouds coming here this week as sign of something? It probably just means he's teasing us and not sending us any more rain. There's nothing. I don't think we need to look for God behind everything. Look for God where he's shown himself to you, and that's where he wants your eyes fixed when it comes to his things.
Yeah,
otherwise,
I don't want to have that computer, if I hit that thing every day on purpose, to be like an idol.
Sheldon, the problem is you feel guilty about everything that God doesn't need you to feel guilty about. You beat yourself up over things that God has not said are sinful. And so what you're doing is you're starting to play God and create rules for yourself that don't exist.
Right.
The point is, you're free in Christ. If you enjoy those video games, by all means, play them. If you start sinning with those video games by telling your kids, I won't talk to you because I have a video game to play, now you've got an actual sin on your hands. Now we have something to worry about. But don't become Luther, where you're going to the confessional to talk for an hour and a half about stuff that's, Luther's confessor said to him one time, at least bring me something interesting, you're just confessing stuff that's not even, you're feeling guilty for no reason.
Right. So why you got to throw the chargers around?
Because just to mess with you. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, though, if you feel like you have to find a reason for everything, then maybe the reason in that is for you to take a moment and just ask yourself, is it becoming more important than it should be? And if that's the case, then it did serve a purpose. But it doesn't necessarily mean that God said, oh, you know, Sheldon's doing too much time on the computer. I'd better break his computer.
Well, something like this is,
yeah.
It's definitely an eye-opener, though, because you realize it's like, I actually know somebody that's playing the game and lives in Nebraska. And I texted them this morning saying, can you send a mass message to the Alliance that I'm going to be off for like a week until I get my computer fixed? So I got somebody from Nebraska telling the rest of the Alliance while I'm not online.
Sheldon, that doesn't make you a sinner. That makes you a nerd. Believe me. This is coming from someone who knows the names of orcs in the Lord of the Rings, right? So I mean, like you're not.
Right.
I can call you that in friendship and love. You know that. I mean that. Okay. Yeah. I mean, I think that's really. I mean, Gary Fenske one time told me, you know, the way we talk about, oh, they're wasting all their time with TV. My parents used to say that to me about books, Gary said. Like, you're wasting your time with books. And now we wish our kids would waste their time with books, right? I mean, it's just the thing of the day. And can you waste your time with books?
Sure, yeah.
No, absolutely not. Books are delightful. But other things, yes. No. Of course.
That was my wife's answer last night, too. She's on show. Pick up a book.
That's a good advice. Yeah. Good, Tom. Yeah.
Can I say I'm officially sorry for even being?
Nope. But you can take credit for that. That's very good. All right. Let's sing the doxology and go home. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Thanks for listening to this Bible study presentation from Faith Lutheran Church in Moore Park, California. We hope this has helped you grow in your Christian faith and study of the Bible. For more information, visit us on the web at faithmoorpark.com.
Music by Kevin MacLeod.